evidence about the shootings.
There was no exchange of words on either side. No warning, nothing said, no screams, nothing, just the shots.
I should say they were from a distance of about 4 feet and that the firing was continuous. In other words, it probably as fast as it is possible to fire, a continuous fire.
Good evening. The killing by the SAS of three IRA terrorists in Gibraltar has provoked intense debate, not only in Britain, but throughout the world, and especially in the Republic of Ireland and the United States. There are perhaps those who wonder what the fuss is about, who ask, does it really matter when or how they were killed? Who say they were terrorists, there's a war on, and we got them before they got us. However, in the eyes of the law and of the state, it is not so simple. The question which goes to the heart of the issue is this. Did the SAS men have the law on their side when they shot dead Mairead Farrell, Danny McCann and Sean Savage, who were unarmed at the time? Were the soldiers acting in self-defense, or were they operating what's become known as a shoot-to-kill policy, simply eliminating a group of known terrorists outside the due process of law, without arrest, trial or verdict? There have been many calls for a public inquiry to establish the facts. The government's insisted that the coroner's inquest in Gibraltar is an adequate forum at which to discover the truth. In either case, we believe that the evidence that this week's uncovered for tonight's special programme is of critical importance for those who wish to find out what really happened in Gibraltar last month. Julian Mannion reports.
Sunday morning on the Costa del Sol, and among the holidaymakers, three Irish terrorists were planning a bloodbath. A white car headed down the coast road, driven by an IRA bomber. The destination was Gibraltar, still Britain's vital military outpost at the entrance to the Mediterranean.
Royal salute!
Royal salute.
Arms!
The IRA have admitted that their plan involved explosives. And all evidence suggests that the target was a ceremony that is a symbol of British tradition on the rock and a major tourist attraction. Every Tuesday morning, in normal times, soldiers and a military band parade in front of the Governor General's residence. The ceremony ends round the corner in a side street 100 yards away. And it was here, at this moment, that the IRA apparently planned to set off a massive car bomb. Instead, three bombers were shot down after carrying out the first stage of their plan, driving in an empty car to secure a parking space as close as possible to their intended victims. In the same street where 140 pounds of high explosive would have detonated, I spoke to a former explosives expert with the British Army. Lieutenant Colonel George Stiles was for 3 years commander of bomb disposal in Ulster. He says the bomb would have annihilated soldiers and spectators alike.
Well, we're talking about it in seconds, but in milliseconds, the car would disintegrate. The shrapnel could go nowhere. It would ricochet off the walls of the building opposite and the wall behind. But above all that, you've got a tremendous concentration of blast because of the building so close together and the smallness of the area and so forth. And in the middle of all that, you've got people.
And what would have been the effect on these people, the band, principally, of the Royal Anglian Regiment?
Well, they wouldn't survive. People are fragmental. They can be torn apart, and they are torn apart by the effects of concentrated blast. And I think anybody in this area would not survive.
Enniskillen, on November 8th last year, showed what a far smaller bomb can do to a mass of people. In this case, civilians gathered together for Remembrance Sunday. The 40-pound bomb had been placed inside a building next to the route of the Remembrance Day parade. In the wave of blast and flying rubble, 11 people died and more than 50 were wounded. Some wounds heal. Others last long after the memory of the atrocity has begun to fade. Until the bomb, Ronnie Hill was the much-loved headmaster of the local high school. Today, his wife Noreen keeps watch as he lives on in a deep coma that may sadly prove irreversible. The coma began during emergency surgery to save Mr. Hill's life after the blast had badly damaged his lungs.
His mind hasn't started to work yet. I mean, he can hear us. He can hear what we're saying. But he can see difference in day and night. He can feel. But he can't move at all. On his own, he can't move.
And you're obviously sustained by the hope that he will get better.
Oh, yes. We have faith that he will get better. The Lord will start his brain working in his time. And we've got to wait until that time.
After Enniskillen, the Provisional's political leadership expressed regret. But in fact, the IRA was already planning the Gibraltar outrage. And one of the Gibraltar terrorists talked about Enniskillen in a recorded conversation in a suburban house in Belfast.
It's all a political act. Even what happened in Enniskillen was a political act. Because it wouldn't have happened if Britain weren't in Ireland.
The speaker was Mairead Farrell, who claimed on tape that she was against civilian casualties because they didn't help the struggle. She had recently been released after serving more than 10 years in prison for planting bombs in a Belfast hotel, an act she committed at the age of 19. In the same tape, she said she was lucky the police didn't shoot her when they found her outside the hotel.
I don't know, mad is in a big prison. Mm-hmm. You know, I was lucky.
In prison, Farrell led the women's dirty protest, smearing excrement on the walls of their cells. After her release, she re-entered the IRA's military structure in a special unit attached to the General Headquarters staff. In the same team were Sean Savage, a committed terrorist known for his bomb-making skills, and Danny McCann, known to British intelligence as one of the IRA's most dangerous killers, who chose to shoot his victims at point-blank range. Last year, McCann was photographed with a cross that he claimed British soldiers had delivered to his door in Belfast. These were the three terrorists who came back dead from Gibraltar. It's now clear that their unit's mission was to strike a major blow to revive IRA morale. Instead, they were tracked and died in what seemed a stunning military success for British forces. But in the way of Northern Ireland, that success is already turning sour, soured by the violence of the following days and by the questions that still surround the deaths in Gibraltar. Where the terrorists, as some have charged, executed.
They put their hands up when they saw these men with the guns in their hands, but they couldn't say anything. There was no interchange of words. It was just shots. Once they dropped down, one of the men, this man who had still had the gun in his hand, carried on shooting. He bent down and carried on shooting at their heads.
Well, it seems to me that if you can get that close to someone, if you can get within 4 feet of your target, is it really necessary to shoot them, or even if it is necessary to shoot them, is it necessary to shoot them to kill them?
It was on November the 5th last year, 4 months before the shooting, that the IRA operation in southern Spain got underway, arriving at Malaga Airport, a member of their special headquarters unit. The terrorist who mingled with the other passengers was Daniel McCann, the gunman from Belfast, carrying a false Irish passport in the name of Riley. As he went through passport control, he appeared to slip through routinely. But in reality, Spanish security police were already watching for him. It turned out that McCann's destination was Torremolinos. In fact, the first tip-off that helped to locate the Irish terrorists here on the Costa del Sol came from London. I'm told that the Spanish police had received a message from the British authorities warning them that an IRA group could be trying to operate on Spanish soil. The message included a list of names together with descriptions and possible aliases. At the Ministry of the Interior in Madrid, the decision was taken to help the British as part of an agreed European strategy against terrorism.
Between the EC countries, we share the same approach to democracy, to freedom, and to terrorism. So although there is no an obligation, a strict obligation, it is quite clear and understanding what is the terrorism, you know, how to fight against.
So in a case like Gibraltar, for example, there would have been no question, there was no question about whether you were going to help or not. You really were committed to doing it.
Well, I think that the answer was given in by the facts.
There was no question but that you were going to go ahead and do what the British asked.
We did.
The Spanish Security Service agreed to track the terrorists wherever they went and keep the British fully informed of their movements. They searched as the IRA unit moved from hotel to hotel, using false passports in various different names. Details of thousands of tourists were sifted by police computers, which checked hotel registration cards against lists of known false documents and names. By mid-November, they had pinpointed three terrorists. Daniel McCann, Sean Savage, and another woman terrorist whom police in both Britain and Spain still refused to name. The fourth member of the IRA unit, she travelled under the false name of Mary Parkin. According to the Spanish security police, their men, disguised as tourists, managed to eavesdrop on the IRA team and overheard them discussing a bomb attack, though the target was not yet clear. On November the 15th last year, McCann and Savage flew from Malaga to Madrid and then back to Dublin. They were allowed to leave by the Spanish authorities, apparently after consultation with London. It seems that both governments believed they would be back. A week later, at the cenotaph in Enniskillen, Mrs. Thatcher laid a wreath in honour of the people who died. On the day of the bombing, she had declared that there should be no hiding place anywhere in the world for the men who did it. Now she must have had on her desk the details of how an IRA unit had been detected in Spain. The question is, how much did the British already know about the terrorist plans? One clear hint came on December the 9th, 3 months before the shootings in Gibraltar, when Home Secretary Douglas Hurd met with the interior ministers of the other EEC countries in Copenhagen. He warned this meeting of what is known as the Trevi Group on Terrorism that the IRA might be preparing to attack British institutions on the continent. In Gibraltar, just the day before the Home Secretary's speech, an unusual event provides another clue. The area where the parade normally takes place was suddenly closed for a facelift, just as it is today. The announcement that guard mounting was suddenly suspended so the guardhouse could be painted was made just the day before in the Gibraltar Chronicle. Was this coincidence? Not according to George Stiles, who has long experience of counter-terrorism.
I would like to say that it was a part of our planning. We stopped the parade, therefore there's no target, therefore no bomb is going to come. It seizes the initiative for a time being from the enemy. Now let's turn the parade on again when we are ready to contain a possible situation that will arise. And in a way, it will confirm to us that we're right in the intelligence we've gathered from them, that they are still intending to blow up that parade on that day, in that place.
Whatever the truth of that, the fact that Gibraltar was the target was certainly confirmed by close cooperation with a special Spanish police unit based at the other end of the Costa del Sol in the town of Malaga. It was from Malaga, I'm told, that a joint Anglo-Spanish team tracked the terrorists when they resumed their operation in February this year. At police headquarters, officers from Spain's crack anti-terrorist squad worked with security officials from Britain.
They will give information to the Spanish police, and it is the Spanish police just to follow people and just to make any action on the Spanish side.
So the British would have had, if you like, a liaison role, but not, would not have actually been doing the following themselves?
Yes, of course.
On Tuesday, February the 23rd, British soldiers in Gibraltar paraded once again in front of their newly painted guardhouse. Among the tourists was the fourth member of the IRA team, the so-called Mary Parkin, who had been tailed here from Spain. She was seen studying the parade in detail. The following Tuesday, March 1st, she was seen again, and it was then, 5 days before the shootings, that events began to move very fast. Belfast, Wednesday, March 2nd, and the IRA's Special Headquarters Unit began to move into action, no doubt alerted by Mary Parkin, who then disappeared. That afternoon, the first member of the team slipped out of Belfast to catch a plane in Dublin. Our information is that Sean Savage, the bomb maker, flew from Dublin to Brussels and then on to Barcelona, where he apparently entered Spain without being immediately detected. He flew down to Malaga early on the following morning. But what the IRA didn't know was that inside the Defence Ministry in London, the Joint Operations Centre was already on alert and preparing to defeat the IRA attack on the Rock of Gibraltar. Thursday, March 3rd, and the bomber, Sean Savage, checked into a hotel in Torremolinos. Like any normal guest, he handed over his passport, but then asked for it back again before the receptionist had remembered to copy out the details. Savage had tricked the system, and police have reprimanded the hotel for their failure to register a terrorist. But that afternoon on the Irish border, another member of the bomb team ran into trouble. Daniel McCann was apparently stopped and questioned by British soldiers on his way to Dublin. The Ministry of Defence have declined to comment on this reported episode. Friday, March 4th, 2 days before the shooting, Sean Savage hired a red Ford Fiesta, the first of the team's three cars. It did more than 1,000 miles, and Spanish police believe that it may have been used to fetch the explosive, which had somehow been smuggled into another part of Spain. That evening, Daniel McCann, the killer from West Belfast, arrived in Torremolinos. It appears that he was under surveillance all the way from Ireland to Spain. He may even have led the Spanish police who were following him to his friend, Sean Savage. Saturday, March 5th, and the Hotel Escandinava was where McCann and Savage were now staying, just 1 day before the shooting. They had checked into this room late on Friday night, and from now on they were under constant surveillance. But the Spanish had completely missed one member of the team. Then, at 12 noon on Saturday, I'm told that an urgent message from London arrived at police headquarters in Malaga. It said, there is another terrorist, and her name is Mairead Farrell. On the basis of this British tip-off, the Spanish police began to hunt for her. Sunday morning, March 6th, a car hire firm in Marbella, just 5 hours before the shootings. Mairead Farrell walked in and gave a cash deposit to hire a car in the false name of Catherine Smith. A few minutes later, she drove the white Ford Fiesta into an underground car park in the center of Marbella. She drove it down to the lower level, which is deserted on a Sunday morning. Police are working on the theory that the red car containing the explosives was already parked here, and that Mairead Farrell now transferred them to the white car, which had been hired with a fresh passport in a new name. £140 of explosives were found in the white Ford Fiesta in the car park 2 days after the shootings. I'm told that until then, neither the Spanish nor British police had any idea they were here. On the final Sunday of the operation, it was this vital question of where the explosives were hidden that came to obsess security officials in both Spain and Gibraltar. While Mairead Farrell and the bomb were apparently out of sight, McCann and Savage had set out from Torremolinos, watched by the police. They met up with Farrell in Marbella, and the IRA team then set out for Gibraltar in two separate cars, both under surveillance. Tailing them, plainclothes officers of Spain's elite anti-terrorist squad. The first IRA car was a white Renault 5 driven by Sean Savage. Later, police reported the red Ford with Farrell and McCann. Each car was expertly tailed with a system the Spanish police demonstrated for us on the same road that the terrorists took that Sunday. Up to four police drivers follow each suspect, constantly interchanging in order to avoid suspicion. I'm told by the Spanish security police that a constant flow of information about the terrorist movements was radioed directly to British officials in Gibraltar. A police helicopter made sure that the watchers made no mistake. The tempting target, symbol for the IRA of British imperialism, had become a carefully prepared trap. Sunday, March the 6th, and the three IRA bombers prepared to cross the border into Gibraltar. Under the eyes of the Spanish police, their two cars met up, and then Savage drove off in the white Renault, leaving the red Ford and the other two terrorists behind in Spain. Just before 1 p.m., Savage drove into the border checkpoint, and the Spanish police allowed him to pass through. On the Gibraltar side, British security officials took over the surveillance, and they too allowed Savage's car to drive through unhindered. Just why British security men did not stop a car that only 2 hours later came under suspicion as a dangerous car bomb is one of the key questions in the Gibraltar affair. And the biggest question as the car crossed the airfield towards the town of Gibraltar is how much was known about what the white Renault actually contained. According to the Spanish security police, they thought it was possible that the car contained a bomb, but they were also working on the theory that the explosives had already been delivered to Gibraltar by sea and that the car was now going to pick them up. British officials have made no public comment on what they believed, but there is little doubt that the car could have been intercepted before it reached the town centre. Instead, Savage drove on, apparently unaware that nearby British troops, including SAS men, were lying in wait. Under surveillance, he drove into the street where the Tuesday parade ends and parked his car beside the ancient city wall. Back at the border at around 2:30 that afternoon, the other two members of the IRA team crossed into Gibraltar on foot. And again, they were allowed to enter unimpeded. In a street near the parked car, they met up with Savage. And then at around 3:30, they all left the area on foot, leaving the parked white Renault behind them unattended. Sir Geoffrey Howe gave this account in the House of Commons.
Their presence and actions near the parked Renault car gave rise to strong suspicion that it contained a bomb, which appeared to be corroborated by a rapid technical examination of the car.
In fact, the car was later found to contain no explosive device. And according to an expert, a rapid examination should have shown that there was no significant bomb in it. George Stiles ran bomb disposal operations in Northern Ireland during his tour of duty there.
Well, I'm sure that the army bomb disposal man was somewhere near and observing the scene. And when the white car came in, he would be told that that's the terrorist bringing in the car, and I'm sure he would have quickly seen that it carried no significant weight of explosive.
How would he have seen that?
Well, the posture of the car on its springs is dictated by the weight it's carrying, and if you put 100 weight of cement in the boot of a car, which is about car bomb size, it shows. Agreed, there could have been a smaller bomb inside it, and I expect the bomb disposal man anticipated such. He would have probably said, this hasn't got a significant bomb in it, but I'm going to treat it with care.
A photograph of the real car taken that day appears to support that view. It shows it riding high on its springs with no load over the wheel arch. At around 3:30, the terrorists began to walk back towards the border. It's now believed that the next phase in their plan would have been to bring in the real car bomb. They would then have put it in their parking space in time for the parade on Tuesday. They left the old town and were more than a mile from the parked car when Farrell and McCann, 100 yards in front of Savage, reached a petrol station, which was closed on Sunday. Then suddenly a burst of shots rang out, and in less than a minute, all three terrorists were dead, shot by the SAS. In the House of Commons, Sir Geoffrey Howe gave this account of what happened.
On their way towards the border, they were challenged by the security forces. When challenged, they made movements which led the military personnel, operating in support of the Gibraltar police, to conclude that their own lives and the lives of others were under threat. In the light of this response, they were shot. Those killed were subsequently found not to have been carrying arms.
Since that statement to the House of Commons, this week has spoken to large numbers of residents in all the blocks of flats overlooking the area where the terrorists died. We have found no one who heard a challenge being made. We have interviewed four key witnesses to the shootings. Their accounts raise serious questions about what really happened that afternoon, for they say that the British soldiers opened fire without warning, and none of them saw the IRA bombers make any threatening movements. The first witness is a housewife, Josie Silesia, whose flat is on the second floor opposite the petrol station.
Well, I saw these two couple, and I was staring at the men, because he had spiky, blonde, short hair, you know. Then all of a sudden, I took my sight off them and looked at the adventure playground. Suddenly, I heard two shots. There were about two shots. So I was just looking from where that came from. And all of a sudden, I saw the woman and, you know, the couple on the floor.
What Josie saw in the first seconds were the terrorists, but little of the SAS men who shot them. But our second witness had a different view with what seems to have been a more complete picture of the shooting. The first thing she says she witnessed was a Gibraltar police car arrive from the direction of the border and suddenly screech to a halt on the other side of the road from the two IRA bombers. Seen at her window, the witness is Carmen Proetta.
I looked out of the window and all of a sudden I saw a car, police car. It stops. All of a sudden, the doors were open, all of them, the four of them, and three men came out dressed in jeans and jackets, jumped over the intersection barrier in the road, guns in hand.
Carmen Proetta has given us a sworn affidavit detailing what she saw. She says she is willing to testify at the inquest, though she has not yet been approached by the police. In a statement that will cause great controversy, she says that the first two terrorists had their hands in the air at the moment they were shot by the SAS. She also says that the British soldiers fired the first shot without warning as they jumped over the central barrier in the middle of the road.
They didn't do anything. They just jumped with the guns in their hands and they just went and shot these people, that's all. They didn't say anything, they didn't scream, they didn't shout, they didn't do anything. These people were turning their heads back to see what was happening. And when they saw these men had the guns in their hand, they just put their hands up. It looked like the man was protecting the girl because he stood in front of her. But there was no chance. I mean, they went to the floor immediately. They dropped.
At the same moment, Stephen Bullock, a British lawyer, was walking with his wife and baby son. He heard shots and looked towards the petrol station.
Outside the petrol station, I saw a man who I'm fairly sure was wearing a bright yellow short-sleeved shirt, standing with both hands outstretched, holding a gun like this, and firing very rapidly into another man with blonde hair, wearing a white shirt, who was falling backwards with his hands like this, and falling back almost in slow motion. He went right down and the firing continued. He was still being shot at as he went down.
And the moment these shots were being fired into him, how close were the two men together?
About as far as I am from you. Say 4 feet.
Really close range?
Oh, yes. Yes, undoubtedly. I mean, close enough. Let's put it this way. I think with one step, he could have actually touched the person he was shooting.
Looking from her window, Josie Silesia saw the terrorists on the ground and an SAS man still pointing his pistol at them.
As you saw the two lying on the ground and another man standing above them, what happened?
I heard shots, about 4 or 5 shots.
More shots?
See?
What were they lying?
Continuously.
Like an automatic fire, no? Automatic. Like that, blah, 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 blah.
See? Like that. One after the other.
Carmen Proeta also saw a gunman fire at the two people who were lying on the ground.
Yes, he bent down and with the two hands he got his gun like that and went on shooting at them.
How many times do you think he shot?
2 times at least.
Mairead Farrell and Daniel McCann were the two terrorists who died by the petrol station. According to our information, which has not been officially confirmed, Farrell was shot twice in the face and once under the left breast in the area of the heart. McCann, the most dangerous terrorist, was shot 8 or 9 times, several times in the chest, and once below the chin, the bullet exiting through the top of his head. Sean Savage, the third terrorist, was not killed in the first burst of shots, as he was about 100 yards behind the others. For some reason, perhaps because he saw or heard the shooting, he ran back towards the old town, pursued by at least one SAS man. Savage died round a corner beside a large oak tree. According to our fourth witness, she was near the tree when a man later identified as Savage ran past her. He was pursued by a second man who had a gun in his left hand.
She just lifted his left arm and I heard the first shot. It was then when I looked back and saw the other man that was running fall back as the other man continued shooting at him.
Did you hear any warning of any kind given by the man with the gun?
No.
Did you hear him say stop?
No.
Police?
No, just happened so sudden.
He just opened fire, just like that?
Yeah.
Our witness says she was only a few feet from the soldier when he opened fire. Later, Savage was found lying face upwards beside the tree. The witness insists that he was shot in the back, with more shots fired as he lay on the ground.
I looked back and I saw the other man that was running just being shot and just fall back.
Fall backwards?
And he was bouncing on the floor when the other man continued shooting at him about 3 or 4 shots more, and I thought he was dead.
You mean you saw the man who was shot in the back?
Yes, through the back.
At this point, the female witness ran away, but we have obtained a dramatic account of what allegedly happened next from another witness who was in a car only a few yards back. Also wishing to protect his identity, he has given a detailed statement to a lawyer representing this week.
The man on the ground was lying on his back. The man standing over this man had his foot on the man's chest. I could see that he also had a gun in his hand. I then saw the gunman point his gun deliberately at the man that was lying on the floor and fire 2 or 3 times into him at point-blank range. I was horrified by what I saw.
Our information is that the bullets that killed Savage were fired into his neck. Only the pathologist's report at the inquest can establish what range they were fired from. A vital question is why the terrorists were not arrested. Was minimum force used? The yellow card rules in Northern Ireland say a soldier may only fire at a person who is likely to endanger life, and there is no other way to prevent the danger. For a fuller legal definition, we asked George Carmen, a leading QC.
The general rule of law is fairly simple to state. Such force as is reasonable or reasonably necessary to prevent crime in order to defend yourself or to defend others is justified in law. But quite obviously, having stated the general principle, everything turns on the particular facts of the case. At the one extreme, there is no unfettered license to kill. At the other extreme, extreme danger requires extreme measures to be taken.
The Renault car in the centre of town was the basis of fears that there was extreme danger to the public. It was suspected that the car contained a bomb. In the week following the shooting, several newspapers carried stories based on Whitehall briefings suggesting that the terrorists could have suddenly set off a car bomb by radio using a miniature device concealed in pocket or handbag. Not mentioned was the fact that the car was almost a mile and a half from the point where the terrorists died, with buildings and a city wall in between. We asked George Stiles if a remote control explosion had been a possibility.
Well, I would say very unlikely indeed. There's so much building work and the undulations of the ground and so on. I doubt if they could ever set that car, the white car, off from the other side of the tunnel. Just on the rock, there's all sorts of radio waves going about. If they could send a signal, I think it would be swamped anyway by the other communications.
Last week, we asked the Ministry of Defence in London if the IRA has ever set off a radio-controlled bomb at a range of more than a mile out of line of sight. The Ministry declined to comment, giving the forthcoming inquest as their reason. Another strange fact is that according to the Gibraltar police who were involved, the area of the Renault car was only cleared at 4 p.m. after the three terrorists had been killed and at least 2 hours after the car was parked. It will no doubt be argued at the inquest that these facts leave out the uncertainties, confusion and fears that often dog military operations. And under the law, the soldiers involved will only have to demonstrate that they held a reasonable belief that the terrorists represented an extreme danger. And it could be argued that a threat to life was posed by the nature of the terrorists themselves. All three had violent records, and McCann was known to be a deadly killer. There was a possibility that he or the others was carrying a concealed weapon, and their reactions, if challenged, could not be predicted. Sir Geoffrey Howe told the House of Commons that when challenged, the terrorists made movements which led the soldiers to conclude that their lives and the lives of others were under threat. But in her most controversial statement, witness Carmen Proetta, who saw the deaths of Farrell and McCann by the petrol station, says that the incident began with the sound of a police siren and that there were no threatening movements from the terrorists.
No. There was no sharp movement. It was the movement of a person that is walking towards somewhere, doesn't know what's going on when they hear a siren, and it's a normal gesture of somebody that just moves when they hear somebody or some noise or some sort of unfamiliar or whatever noise.
And then as they turned, they must have seen coming towards them over this railing,
yes,
men with guns. What movements did they make then, these two terrorists?
They didn't make any movements. They put their hands up. I believe I've said it before. Yes, they just put their hands up.
Was this a reflexive gesture, or were they actually trying to give themselves up, do you think?
It was like giving themselves up, like unresisting gesture.
An unresisting gesture?
An unresisting, yes.
As if they were trying to surrender, is what you're saying?
Yes, like saying, look, what's happening, we haven't done anything, or some sort of like that.
Well, this is the killing ground. This is
George Stiles, who is also a ballistics expert, believes that what Carmen saw could be explained by the impact of bullets travelling faster than the speed of sound, striking the terrorists and throwing their hands in the air. But reviewing the shooting as a whole, he believes that a clear-cut decision was taken to eliminate the terrorists as cleanly and safely as possible.
I look at the whole piece as being two active service units waging war, and thank goodness our side won. The battlefield was one of their choosing in the first place, that is the general community, and I think it would be reckless for the security forces to have tangled with these people who may well have been armed, as we've seen on other occasions. So taking them out quickly, cleanly, and without other people getting hurt, that seems to be the only way.
What is important on the one hand is that Her Majesty's government take all proper effective steps to stamp out the scourge of terrorism, and I imagine that's beyond dispute. Equally, on the other hand, it is important that the measures that are taken, however extreme and necessary they are, fall within the rule of law, which governs us all. because even the activities of soldiers or police officers who have to face the awful problem of terrorism has to be conducted within the framework of the rule of law. So, of course, it is desirable that there should be a full examination of what actually occurred.
Our inquiries into the shootings in Gibraltar have revealed a number of important and troubling issues. No independent witness has told us that they saw or heard the security forces challenge the terrorists. Carmen Proetta has sworn in an affidavit that she saw two of the bombers shot with their hands in the air. Another witness says she saw the third terrorist shot in the back as he ran away. Two witnesses say that they saw the terrorists being finished off while they lay on the ground. And deeply disturbing, George Stiles, an acknowledged expert on bomb disposal, says that the security forces should have known within minutes of examining the white Renault 5 that there was no significant bomb in the car. Clearly, all these questions require deep and complex investigation to establish the truth, but doubt remains as to whether that will happen. One reason for disquiet is the role in the shootings of the Gibraltar police. They apparently drove the SAS men to the scene and certainly took them away again minutes later. One question is whether the police force that helped to carry out the operation is the right body to investigate it. Another question concerns the nature of the coroner's court where this highly controversial inquest will eventually take place in this small outpost of empire. The court can produce a wide range of verdicts, including, in theory, homicide. But Mr. Felix Pizzarello, the coroner, would be the first to admit that both his experience and powers to investigate are limited. The Prime Minister has declared that his inquest is where the facts should be established, but a leading QC has doubts.
The coroner's court is a perfectly proper place to investigate ordinary fatalities. But where great public interest and matters of public importance are involved, such as this case that you've been talking about, it seems to me desirable that some senior judicial power, such as a High Court judge, would be much more appropriate to be appointed to investigate a matter and preside over an inquiry of this kind.
Do you believe this case is so important that the government should actually consider such extraordinary steps in order to clarify the facts?
It's not for me to advise Her Majesty's government as to what steps they should take. But clearly, from everything you say, the programme indicates that there are serious, important public issues involved. And speaking as a lawyer, one is always anxious that where there is contest on the facts in such important areas, they should be properly and efficiently investigated.
That report by Julian Mannion was made, as you may have detected, without the cooperation of the British government, which says that it'll make no comment until the inquest. As our film contained much new evidence, hitherto unavailable to the coroner, we're sending the transcripts to his court in Gibraltar, where it's been made clear to us that all such evidence is welcomed. From this week, good night.